But I just want to hit some highlights from the legislative session here that I've just finished. This is my very first session as a legislator. I had the pleasure of working as a staffer back in the early 80s. My first job, real job out of college, was working for State Representative George Sheldon from Tampa. And when he got appointed to chairman of the House Gov Ops Committee, he elevated me to, promoted me to an analyst on a committee staff. So I got to do that for 4 years. So it's been a long time since I've been in the legislature, so it's nice getting to being elected to represent District 68 and going back as a member. And man, is it different being the guy in the hot seat, because there are really just two buttons. There's a yes, a no, and I couldn't find a maybe, but you know, so there are tough choices to be made. I'll talk to you more about those if I can remember the oral cancer bill being one of the kind of interesting choices that we had to make that wasn't all completely good. The cancer side of the bill was, but things that got added late in the session weren't. We'll talk more about that. But hey, Paula, welcome. So we dealt with elections. Gave greater discretion to the supervisors to extend voting periods and so on. They got restricted pretty seriously the year before last. We had a driver's license bill for the Dreamers, essentially. People were here, children of immigrants that wanted to get legal and to be able to have a legal driver's license. It was passed by both the Senate and the House. The governor vetoed it, so that didn't make it. We have we passed, I'm very proud, and these are some bills that I co-sponsored. The renewable and alternative energy device bill, which essentially exempted assessments of these alternative and renewable devices. So now you can put alternative renewable devices on your homes and not have them included in the assessments when the tax assessor looks at your property. So that's a great thing to encourage people to have clean energy and to reduce pollution in our state. The school emergency EpiPen, pretty basic thing. You got an EpiPen now in the schools you can use if a child is having a reaction, we can save them and do it without red tape and having them die waiting for the EpiPen to come. I co-sponsored a bill that didn't pass reporting requirements for economic development, which is basically accountability for tax incentives. About $1.7 billion have been given to very big companies mostly. Last year, the year before, Digital Domain, a company down south in Fort Lauderdale, had received about a $20 million boost. Hey, Manuel. They went bankrupt, and $20 million went to them, and they haven't been able to recoup the money. So that's kind of serious, that there aren't enough mechanisms in place to recoup money that is given. That's our money, taxpayer dollars, that we give, and we certainly deserve to have a better use of that money. Natural gas motor fuel. This was a development, a incentive program to encourage the use of natural gas throughout our state. Natural gas burns significantly, maybe 70-80% cleaner than regular gasoline. With the expansion of extraction of natural gas, there's a great supply of it, 100 to 150 year supply, creating a connection of natural gas stations, as well as giving incentives for natural gas conversion to natural gas vehicles. Was part of that legislation, and we're very happy that the governor did sign that. Bullying in public schools. Public schools didn't think that they should be responsible for some of the cyberbullying that's going on. We've already seen horrible examples that have occurred throughout the nation where kids have committed suicide. Nobody knew that they were suffering like they were. That bill passed and is law. The EBT, the electronic transfer cards bill, prior to this law, shockingly enough, you could use an EBT card at race tracks, strip clubs, and casinos. And we decided that probably wasn't a good use of those cards. And shockingly enough, we got that through, that passed. So now you can't spend all the food stamps that you get for your kids and so on at the strip club or the racetrack. The animal cruelty bill allows separate counts to be made when you have a group of animals. Instead of just having one count for a group of animals, you can actually have separate counts for each animal that is abused. Termination of parental rights. Prior to this last session, if you were a rapist, you could claim parental rights and go into dependency proceedings and demand to have visitation, which I think we all would agree that is an outrageous, crazy thing. That, fortunately, that law was passed, so someone who rapes somebody can't claim parental rights later on. Deceptive and unfair trade practices. It passed in one arena and didn't in another. It passed for veterans, so if people engage in unfair and deceptive trade practices against veterans, they can be sued at a higher rate, treble damages. The bad part of the FDUPTA was that a bill was passed, which I voted against and argued against vigorously, which used to protect consumers more by allowing attorney's fees to be paid if you prevail. So if you get ripped off by a car lot, new or used or whatever, you could sue and recover damage. You could sue, recover damages that you were owed, but instead of having to go out of your own pocket, you can have your attorney's fees paid as well. Seemed like a reasonable, just thing. Sadly, that was taken away. That bill passed. Human trafficking, public records for human trafficking, allowing people that are caught up in human trafficking, if it's proven that they were, they were trafficked people and they were exploited, they could have their records sealed. If they were pressed into prostitution or something, which is a common thing, they could have their records sealed afterward. Purchase of firearms by mentally ill people. Not a great idea, is it? Well, we passed a law to stop people that have voluntarily committed themselves to state hospitals or institutions to not be allowed to buy firearms when they get out without clearance from the circuit court. So they have to be examined, go before a judge, whereas before they could, believe it or not, do that. They could go buy a gun after getting out of a mental institution. The nuclear, and this is a very complicated name, nuclear and integrated gasification combined cycle power plants. That's just coal-fired and nuclear gas plants, essentially, they're referring to. And the bill that was passed this session pertained to making it a little harder for these power companies, utility companies, to be able to take money from us. It didn't do near what I wanted it to. I voted for this bill. I thought it fell way short, but it did something. So I voted for it. Another bill was massage establishments. Instead of having massage parlors staying open 24/7, which is a great, very often a front for prostitution and criminal enterprises, that was changed. They're not allowed to stay open all nights and so on. The Everglades Improvement and Management monies, $32 million to help us reclaim our Everglades. Those were some of the bills, the co-sponsored bills. The bills that I personally sponsored was a PSC bill. I tried to reorganize the PSC. PSC has say-so over the utility companies, the investor-owned utilities. They approve all the rate hikes, and there are way too many rate hikes. It's been this way since it switched from an appointed, from an elected PSC. Now it's all appointed, has been for the last 30-something years. Anybody in here name one PSC member? Can anybody name one? It's a trick question, but it illustrates what I'm talking about, and that is that we are out of touch with the people that have so much power over us. These PSC members vote and pass almost all the utility hike requests. And so, and many of them sadly go to work for the utility companies afterward. So I proposed a bill to make them elected, to have them run in regions. There, we could divide the state into five regions. There are five PSC members. We would have an identifiable PSC member that we would know his phone number or her phone number and where they were, and to make our complaints to try to do something about nothing but an upward spiral in our energy costs, and they're constantly approving rate hikes. The other bill I had, another one, was the Fallen Heroes license plate. I figured that if wildflower license plates could be, you know, passed, that we could honor the three murdered St. Pete police officers that were killed in 2011. Sadly and shockingly, that did not pass. It did not get heard. Religious foster home improvement for regulations and certification. A form of that bill passed to make it a little harder for, they were finding that there were rampant abuses and a number of small religiously run, like foster homes and such, where there was some physical abuse and so on. Some standards passed this time, so they're making it a little safer for kids. Implementation of the Department of Education rules. Instead of making schools implement rules immediately, there should be at least 30 days for the department to explain what the rules are. Many times the rules are just spoken or orally transmitted instead of written. You figure if a rule is good enough to make, it's good enough to write down and good enough for us to be able to read. PW Ventures. Believe it or not, in Florida, if you put, if your business, you have a big roof and you put a bunch of solar panels on your roof and you generate enough power to sell to other people, the PSC, our friends at the Public Service Commission, will consider you to be a power company, a utility company, and they will want to regulate you. It is absurd. There are other states that are deregulated that allow this kind of, the PW Ventures stands for a court case where Pratt Whitney Enterprises built some buildings. They were going to sell some power to a credit union on their property. The power companies sued and they stopped it. Sadly, you know, this power, they were generating a lot of power, some kind of heat transfer, geothermal, whatever, but it got killed, and that's the state of things in Florida. You can't sell power to anybody except to the power company, and you sell to the power company at the absolute cheapest rate. So there's kind of a captive rate. You can't, you know, have a profitable market. There's no incentive for all the big box stores, Walmart and Best Buy and all the big companies that have huge roof space could generate a lot of power and sell it. We'd have a smaller carbon footprint in the state. It would be better for us, you know, in many, many respects, and also maybe offer a little competition to the monopoly power companies. Okay, so those were some of the bills that I sponsored. Welcome, Glenn. Come join us.
Thank you.
Nice to see you again. you know, we passed the budget. That's one of the things we have to do every year. Funded some raises for teachers that have been, waiting patiently for raises. Things aren't all great in education. Obviously, we need more funding, but there was some additional funding for some charters and for I think the tax credit scholarships had some more money this year. I know that Glenn would like even more. I had the pleasure of going to St. Petersburg
Christian Academy.
Thank you. And we had a very nice time there, a very beautiful school, nicely run. And I know Glenn is a huge advocate for the corporate tax scholarship and Step Up and so on. So we'll be talking more. We'll see a lot of Glenn in Tallahassee in the coming session. I want to tell you just a brief story about a young man who was at a new public school. He'd been at private school, went to a public school, and first day of school, he saw a pen under the bleachers, and he dove under to get it, and he got his hand on it, and a big kid shoved him aside. He had the skinny kid had the pen. Big kid said, "I'm gonna beat your tail if you don't give me that pen." Skinny kid said, "No, I got older brothers. I fight. I'm not afraid of you. I'm keeping this pen. It's finders keepers, and it's not yours." So he said, "Well, I'm gonna beat you up right now." He says, "Well, bring it. Let's do it." So, or so many words. So he ends up. The bully looks at his watch and says, "I don't have time to beat you today, but I will see you again." So he, skinny kid goes home, he rides the bus next day, he's back at school, and all of a sudden, he's getting off the bus, as soon as his feet hit the school property, someone taps him on the shoulder, he turns around and gets blasted in the face. And a fight ensues. And they're going at it. This is a big kid and a short, skinny kid. And they're fighting. And no teachers are breaking it up. It's kind of in an isolated area. They go at it for a while. They're doing it, fighting for 20 minutes or so. Finally, a teacher comes over to break it up. Skinny kid still got the pen in his top pocket, but the rest of his shirt is kind of ripped and bloody. And the boys, a number of the kids there, were treating that short, skinny kid like a hero because he stood up to the bully. Well, I had that pen until about 15 years ago when we moved. And this is where we are now today. And this is what I'm fighting for. I'm fighting for the things like fighting against the utility tax and fighting against the cell phone companies and fighting against citizens' insurance. I had the opportunity to go the other day in Tampa to the rate hike hearing, and I was shocked to hear the consumer advocate for the Office of Insurance Regulation. I thought she worked for Citizens Insurance, and even though she has that official title of consumer advocate, I was really stunned to hear how important and great it is to raise rates higher on consumers. And it seems like nothing is being done in favor of consumers. And that's the story across the board. And certainly, this fight is much more important than a pen. But it is about fairness. And that's what that fight was about, that pen, because that was just a basic in fairness, right? Finders keepers, everybody knows these playground rules, these school rules that we learned in kindergarten maybe. And here we have utility companies continuing to take money, and they've announced the chief executive for Duke Energy has said, "Okay, we're not building nukes anymore. We want to build other stuff. And we're so happy this money is laying around. $2 billion have been taken from us so far. and I have fought and fought about that. And I'm happy to say that standing up to this powerful power company, Duke Energy, and progress before them has resulted in Crystal River being shut down. They're going to keep taking our money and keep spending it. Of course, they're going to have to keep taking more of it because they're going to take 60 years to decommission that plant. I know it's maybe a great thing for tourism. Maybe we can have tours of the abandoned nuclear plant at some point, but I guess it has to be less radioactive at that, you know, before that can happen. But this is an important fight. And the great thing, too, is the good news of Levy County, them not building in Levy County, because it started at $6 billion. That was the price tag when they tricked people into voting for it. I won't say that. People should have looked harder and known better than to vote for such a expensive and outrageous plan. $6 billion initially. Finally, the final cost was estimated somewhere around $25 or $26 billion. So, story ran in the paper, and I credit the Tampa Bay Times for doing investigative reports and pointing out that they could have built two natural gas plants that generated as much power for $3 to $4 billion less. That $3 to $4 billion is coming out of our pockets. But it doesn't stop there. Mary Richard, my wife, is sitting in the back row here, and I had an experience recently with a cell phone company. Because we have three kids, a 20, 17, and 15-year-old, we initially had locator services on their phones. You know, we want to know where they are. If they're not calling home, we'd like to know where they are. We realized after a couple months, maybe Mary Rachel did, that we didn't need to have that. So we called the company and said, take that off. We don't need that. They said, fine. Sadly, 12 months later, we noticed it's still in the bill. Of course, our bill's kind of fat, having three kids, and you guys have your bills too, so you know what I'm talking about. And sometimes they hide these things, and the print's a little finer than what I used to be able to read. I need maybe a better pair of reading glasses or something. But I did catch it, saw it. We called the company. I was on the phone for an hour, and after pointing it out and then admitting that they did do this to us, they said they would refund the money. So I was happy, but then they said they would only refund 3 months of 12 months. 12 months they took. And since phone deregulation has occurred in Florida, you can't get them to give you more than 3 months back, even if they steal the money from you. Called slamming, right? We had another experience with our oldest. We bought him an iPhone 5 for Christmas. Somehow, even though we have a family share plan, they tagged him with a 300-minute anywhere plan, or whatever they call it. And we find this out a couple months later and say, look what you all have done now. You're ripping us off here too. What's going on? And they won't refund more than 3 months. How can that be? I, as an attorney, if I bill you, you know, for a year and pretend I'm providing you services and I'm not, I can be disbarred. Same with doctors, probably plumbers and everybody else. You can't steal money, claim it's yours just because the customer didn't find it. That's really outrageous. And so we followed further, said, you know, I want to talk to your boss, up the chain of command. I said, the last person I talked to said, look, I'm really sorry. The rules have changed. We can rip you off now. He didn't say it just like that, but he said, in so many words, we can rip you off now. It was much more polite than that, but, you know, thank you for being polite as you steal my money.
Just like shit, I'm sorry.
Duke Energy, you know, all these companies, sadly, are not, you know, they're not being good corporate citizens. They're not being fair and reasonable. So what I learned, and this is really disturbing, and I hate to give this bad news, but you can contact the FCC. Now, how many people contact the FCC in here? Me either. And I found out an informal complaint is free, but if I want to make a formal complaint, it's $200. So these are the kind of things that the, for instance, the Unfair and Deceptive Trade Practices Act need to include. The power companies can't keep taking money from us like they are. We need to have the insurance companies, citizens, and the rest, mitigation credits. You know, you spend $10,000 on hardening your home. They come out, look at your house, and they say, well, we'll give you a discount of $200 a year. We got, Mary Rachel and I got a $1,200, I think it was $1,200, in 1 year in mitigation credits because we had done a bunch of the house, replaced our windows and all this. The next year they said it was no good. So that $1,200 that we saved in 1 year is no longer saved. And that's, you know, there's really nobody stopping that. They throw out a figure with the Office of Insurance Regulation that 82% of people as citizens are getting mitigation credits. But we don't know how much the individual spends. If you spend $5,000 or $10,000 on improvements on your home and they give you $100, that's not a very fair return, especially if you qualify for a number of other things. So these are all issues that I'm looking at. I appreciate your input. I appreciate your stories. I knocked on about 4,000 doors last year when I was running. And these were issues that were near and dear to the hearts of the voters, particularly property insurance, particularly the power bill. And these are things I believe that the loyal opposition, the other side, believes in what they're doing. I don't want to demonize, won't try to do that. I believe in good policy. I believe we have to work for good policy, that it's not about politics, that we need to fight for and work for fairness, a more level playing field, that middle class, working people, poor people deserve fair treatment. And that's all we're asking for, and that's what we're fighting for. And I'll keep fighting. I appreciate you fighting with me. I appreciate your support. I'm happy to try to answer any questions that you might have. Yes, sir.
What I did, I brought a map with me, the Tampa Bay watershed.
Yes,
we've had a number of meetings. What we're looking at, Tampa Bay is a lot cleaner than it used to be.
Sure.
But we feel there's no reason why not to try to make it even cleaner. The two biggest polluters in Tampa Bay are runoff and basically exhaust from the vehicles from Cuba to Atlanta.
Well, that goes back to natural gas, doesn't it? One answer.
What we're looking at is what counties, because the biggest one is runoff, what counties have what's called LID, low impact development. Sarasota's already got it, and if you look at the map there, Sarasota's got a little piece of Pinellas. We spoke to the planning director yesterday and his boss. They've got it where they're gonna put it in place shortly. Some of the other counties might not be as friendly, so I don't want to put you on the spot tonight, but I'd like to talk to you. I don't know
about this. I would love for you to give your information to Matt and Brian and set up a time and come in. I'd love to talk to you about it. I certainly am interested in improving our environment. Big thing for me that I'm going to really devote myself to is trying to help Florida save our springs. As you know, we're in horrible shape. Where a lot of the springs are getting, just buried in algae, and it's a huge tourism draw to the state's an economic engine. Never mind a strong indicator of how good our environment is. If our springs are empty, that's kind of a bad sign. And I don't care how much water Tampa Bay Water can make by desalinating. I don't think we want to, put all our eggs in that basket of just desalinization and surface water treatment. So sure. Thank you. If you'll just give your information now, I appreciate your input.
Great. Thanks.
I have a
Sure.
I know recently they've been looking into adding civic education into middle schools.
Adding what?
Civic education.
Civic, yeah.
Yeah, into middle schools. But is there any talk to adding it more to the high school age group where they're more at the age where they're going to start voting, they're going to start doing things instead of 13-year-olds?
I'm not on any education committees, but I know the value and the importance of education. I've been very involved in early learning and infant mental health. I think that's crucial. I think that instead of us spending lots of money on the back end, where people are going to jail and prison, and that we're having programs there, that we can save a lot of our people and do better for them on the front end. And a lot of it is, instead of having them get a slow start in school and doing poorly and being disenchanted and emotionally dropping out very early, that we can have them engaged, and that the early learning programs and the infant mental health programs are critical to that. Civics, a number of subjects, it's funny what just happened in the legislature just in this last session. For instance, the CAPE bill. For a long time, they were raising the standards on what was required for high school students to graduate. But they're finding that a very significant segment of the population is not interested in going to college, or maybe is not equipped, or just purely is not interested. So they may be more involved in tech education. And so now there's been a sort of a two-track set made with the CAPE bill, which allows for industry certification for kids that want to get tech trained. They can maybe get certification through Microsoft or some of the other Apple or some of the other computer companies if they want to do that, or maybe look at engineering tech stuff, basically STEM, the science, technology, engineering, and math. I like STEM, but I also like STEAM. I think we need to include the arts too. I think as part of a well-rounded education, that we should include the arts. Certainly civic education is important, that we don't help create the leaders of tomorrow if they don't recognize the democracy we live in and participate in it. Obviously, that's a critical part of it. But I think there were civic class requirements made some years ago, and that they're sort of looking at it again and trying to decide whether the money's being spent relative to educating in math or some of the STEM education, how that compares. So that is something that's of interest. If you would also give if you have a particular issue, if I'm not covering it to the degree that you'd like me to, or I admit to not knowing a lot about that, but I have heard of some of the talk, and I think it's approximately where I'm telling you. So if that's a crucial issue for you, I'm happy to look at it further. And I know it's important too. I just don't know where it is in the